This is an issue of people using people, of trafficking people to make money for themselves.
So many people think that it's just a big city problem, and they don't realize that it's happening all around them in small towns and in large communities.
Sex trafficking or prostitution is happening in Stearns County.
We have software that kind of collects all the advertisements on multiple different websites. We find that outside of Minneapolis, St. Paul, St. Cloud is probably the number one area in our state.
The access to pornography that's available on the internet has fueled a lot of this.
The word violent, when you say that, that is the word that best describes what is happening to these victims. It's pure violence.
Hundreds of thousands of dollars is being made by trafficking women.
More and more youth are being targeted.
And their ultimate goal is to meet up and have sex with that juvenile.
This is about money, this is about profit, this is about drugs, and this is about selling people like you'd order something at Target. It's beyond our expectations.
We started to doing some basic investigations, really wanted to try to assess the scope of the problem. And I had gotten a call from the State Human Trafficking Task Force that they had recovered a 16-year-old juvenile female runaway out of the Twin Cities in our city.
When we first had a drive-by shooting outside a hotel in Wake Park and realized that there was a teenage girl being sold inside, and the fight was about how the buyer had not followed the trafficker's rules with this particular girl, we started to look at what was really going on in the shadows of the community.
And so we started to do a series of knock and talks at this local motel where we just knock on the door. We started looking at some of the social media websites that existed back at the time. There were 15 to 20 women that had posted ads. That was obviously got our attention.
It had been there all along, but we didn't know until we opened our eyes to the reality of it.
After that, we thought, well, what's the demand for this? And so we set up a fake ad of our own, and we tied it to a cell phone number. And within 24 hours, we had 75 phone calls to that fake ad, to that cell phone. And so that told us, or told me, that we have a problem.
In 2014-15, I was in charge of the Central Minnesota Violent Offender Task Force, and I was tasked with, by the sheriffs at the time and the police chiefs, to kind of work on it for a summer. We probably identified 61 victims of sex trafficking. And so it was kind of an eye-opener for, I think, all the chief law enforcement people at the time.
When they hear the word sex trafficking, people think different things. Some people think that their child is going to get stolen from the mall and be taken into a sex trafficking ring, and they're not looking at what the real issue in central Minnesota and in Minnesota really is, which is a lot bigger than that. There's a lot more things to be concerned about than that. It's what your children are looking at on social media, who they're speaking with.
Sex trafficking really preys on our most vulnerable victims in any community. It preys on our youth, it preys on those who are already dealing with other struggles. And the most critical thing about it is that it kind of flies under the radar of what traditional law enforcement sees.
When you're talking about selling multiple persons multiple times a day, the amount of money that's been made is why we're having a hard time getting to some of those bigger traffickers. This is big money. And the persons who are going to have to testify to hold you criminally accountable, you know what you've put them through, and you know what they've been through, and you know that that manipulation is why they're in the life. So your chances of getting caught, that cost-benefit analysis, that's why they keep it up.
So many people think that it's just a big city problem, and they don't realize that it's happening all around them in small towns and in large communities. And so we know there are victims throughout the state of Minnesota, in all areas of Minnesota. And so it's a very large problem. That's the way it is in our country. And so, yes, it's a very big problem.
So the legal definition of sex trafficking is pretty broad. It has four different areas that you can prosecute in. One is that somebody engages in sex trafficking. One is that somebody receives profits of prostitution. One is that somebody promotes the prostitution of an individual. The fourth one is that somebody solicits or induces prostitution.
Sex trafficking, or human trafficking, which combines both labor and sex, is actually the second largest criminal enterprise in the world, usually falling just under drugs. And so we know that, like drugs that happen everywhere, you don't get to be that large of a criminal enterprise without happening everywhere as well. We actually found that central Minnesota, or east central Minnesota, which includes St. Cloud and surrounding counties, had one of the highest percentages of self-disclosures from youth, higher than either metro region.
This is different than prostitution. This is an issue of people using people, of trafficking people to make money for themselves, to profit for themselves at total expense of the victim.
Human trafficking is exactly like drug dealing, except for you have a human being. You're exchanging a human being or a life for money.
A more common term, sort of out-of-date term, is a pimp, is what a sex trafficker would be. We refer to them as sex traffickers. So it's someone that's receiving profit or promoting the prostitution of a victim.
The Central Minnesota Human Trafficking Task Force actually started when we realized that this was going on in our community.
Our main goal was to go after the traffickers. There were these mostly men that were trafficking women, making huge amounts of money.
When we started the Central Minnesota Human Trafficking Task Force, we knew that law enforcement couldn't be the only piece. Law enforcement is kind of the end of the road that we needed to get to the beginning of the road of how is this happening to begin with. And then once we found victims, how do we help them back out of the life? We can prosecute the trafficker, we can put him in prison, but her life and her experiences are there.
So here we have a multidisciplinary team that really is really robust. We have social services, including child protection, child welfare, probation. We have Terebinth Refuge, which serves adult women. We have our LSS programs, our Lutheran social service programs, including My Safe Harbor programs. We have the shelters included in that for the homeless shelters or warming centers. We have CentraCare for health care included, law enforcement from multiple jurisdictions, the county attorney's office, the city's attorney's office. We have people represented from Benton County, Stearns County.
Our task force also does take on the cases where a parent calls up and says, I found that my daughter was sending nude photos to somebody and I don't know who and if they're an adult and where they live. And so some of our resources go to electronic solicitation of a minor, which is a really big piece of the task force as well.
We have a high-risk runaway program. So there's certain criteria that'll flag a child runs away three or more times.
And so now we have state grant funding that will allow us to staff three investigators.
So in our task force, we will have the three investigators, data analysts, victim assistance coordinator, and the prosecutor.
This task force that's funded in central Minnesota to investigate trafficking and prosecute trafficking crimes is also putting forth funds, time, resources to create educational material to go out and educate the community. There's some common myths that are really promoted by our media and as well as social media, where we find that people really think that this is an issue of kidnapping and abduction. But really what it is it's relationships that are formed between an exploiter and a victim or a trafficker and a victim, and there's a grooming process that takes place.
The victims look like anyone else in the community. We find people that are looking for a way out, that are easily manipulated. Commonly, we see persons who have experienced some sort of trauma in their life, and then this manipulative person comes in and says, I can make your life better. You're beautiful, you're valuable, and gives them something within themselves that's not there.
One thing that is always kind of shocking to me, or makes me sad, I guess I would say, is the way that these victims see themselves. Like, they generally seem to have no self-worth. You know, they refer to themselves in derogatory terms.
Almost all of them have some sort of chemical dependency, we find, where they're addicted to drugs mostly, sometimes alcohol, or a combination of the two. We get a lot of single moms that are trying to make money for their family or got roped into this is the only way they can make money to support their kids.
Once she is in the life, getting back out is going to cost something. And the amount of violence that we see, that was one of the early things that we found, is actually victims that had been severely beaten.
And so a victim can be majority women and girls, but there are also boys and men that are trafficked and exploited as well. Some of them, of these boys and men, might be transgender folks or LGBTQ folks that have been pushed out of their home society, and they are vulnerable. All ages, younger children are exploited and trafficked, and all the way up to adults who have been in this for years and have not been able to find a way to get out.
The idea that they can just walk away, it's just so much more complicated than that. The traffickers, the people who are actually getting people into the life so that they can then profit from them, are criminals. Career criminals.
They have a history of selling narcotics, running guns. They found that trafficking women is another way to make money.
The sex trafficker usually is a boyfriend. There isn't a specific race, there isn't a specific age. It is in the 20s to 50s.
And then at some point, usually there's kind of a seed planted, you know, about making some extra money. It's always this promise of them building a life together, even though the victim is the only one that has to do the prostitution or you know, make sacrifices in that regard.
We also know there is a significant amount of familial trafficking happening within our state as well. So familial trafficking means that it's a parent or a caregiver, something within that family unit that is trafficking and exploiting them.
Sometimes the trafficker is the one who, just because of the relationship dynamics, is in charge of all of the money, even if they're not the one making the money. A lot of these cases intersect with domestic violence, where there's already a power differential, where the boyfriend or the person that they've had children with is just in charge of everything.
In every case I've worked, someone that's close to them, that had a relationship to the victim and manipulated them into this lifestyle through some means, whether it's through force or fraud or coercion, it's almost always there with someone who's close to them.
Some of these people that I prosecute for sex trafficking now, 5-10 years ago, I was prosecuting them for domestic violence and domestic assaults, and I had no idea at that time, nor was there evidence out there that sex trafficking was happening. But when you combine those two dynamics, you don't need a lot more to convince somebody to make money for the family when the alternative might be that they will be assaulted.
And there's violence associated with it, because oftentimes the individuals that are conducting sex trafficking are finding ways to keep their victims from reporting, keep their victims dependent on them.
But we'll interview victims that they have sex assaults, like rapes and assaults, that they didn't report to law enforcement at the time because they felt like they couldn't. There was nobody they could have talked to because they felt like they would get in trouble. That after the fact you learn they've been assaulted multiple times by both buyers and traffickers, that they've been raped by buyers and traffickers.
But for the most part, they are beholden to anything they need and want from the trafficker.
In central Minnesota, as well as around the whole state, buyers are predominantly middle-aged men, married men with families, middle class.
Sometimes we see people coming from another area to this area because we have more ads here than in some of the smaller towns. But they're married, employed men with children who are doing this on their lunch breaks and the way home from work.
Sex buyers in central Minnesota can range from any age, 18 to 70 something. You know, we've had all across the board, any race. It really has no boundaries. You never know who's going to show up.
The sex trafficking in central Minnesota is in the hotels and motels, although now we've trained all of those staff in what to look for, and they do call and they do report. So we're seeing more of it in apartments, in houses. Literally one of the traffickers that we had offered up his house in exchange for sex. You can use my place. Rather than getting cash for it, he charged sex for it.
Buyers are connecting with victims through online ads, and there's various platforms for that, Mega Personals, Skip the Games, List Crawler. I could go on and on and on. There's too many to count, really.
And then a lot of times they meet on something like that, but then somebody will say, you know, here's my Snapchat name, you know, add me to Snapchat, and then we'll communicate through that, or a phone number, or whatever other means. So it's kind of they initiate the conversation there, and then they quickly move it to another platform where they can kind of have one-on-one direct communication.
There's also other things, too, that we've come across where the victim may have like a Twitter page or an Instagram account. And I think information on there leads these buyers to believe they may be able to meet someone that way, so they may contact a victim through those platforms as well that are maybe more mainstream.
The access to pornography that's available on the internet has fueled a lot of this.
What I had an officer say to me is that not everyone who watches porn buys a woman, but this officer said every buyer that I've gotten and talked to, they were in porn, had been addicted or had used porn. And so it really changes and shifts the brain, it causes an addiction, and then they're wanting to more and more and more and more, and eventually buying someone to fulfill the fantasies they see in the pornography.
Most buyers are repeat buyers. When I go through phone downloads and other information, I'll see oftentimes just the way that a buyer is talking to a victim. I'll think, I think I've heard this guy before. I think I know who this might be.
The buyers are spending a lot of money on this for each individual transaction. We frequently see as much as 100, 200, 300 bucks to meet up with someone to have sex for time increments as low as 15 minutes, 30 minutes. It's not infrequent to see people spend, you know, $300, $400 in one sitting just to have sex with somebody.
In this day and age, so much of it is done online.
The traffickers are different than the persons who we're seeing soliciting kids for sex, which is different.
They are looking for vulnerable children that are on different chat rooms, online spaces, and they are looking for children that are saying, oh, my life sucks and things aren't going good for me, my parents don't understand, I'm bullied at school, no one understands me. Someone who's looking for friendship, companionship, a boyfriend, because maybe all their girlfriends at school has boyfriends.
And what they'll typically do, it's called a grooming process. They'll introduce themselves typically as the same age or roughly the same age as the boy or girl they're texting with. And they'll basically just start in a relationship that looks pretty normal as you first start reading the conversation. But it'll turn into, a lot of times they'll ask for a naked photograph or something like that. And then once they get that, they kind of got their hooks into them, and they'll use that as blackmail, saying that we're going to blast this out on your social media account to all your friends, and then they keep getting more photos.
I think the men that are soliciting these juveniles, for the most part, what I've seen, at least to date, is they're looking for a sexual relationship for themselves, a sex act. We have not come across yet where we've seen them locate this juvenile victim and then turn them into a victim as far as sex trafficking goes.
We do a lot of work on chat rooms that a lot of these guys will go on the internet specifically seeking out how to have sex with kids, and they try to hide it really well. They'll create fake social media profiles, fake email accounts, a whole fake alter ego in some cases. They'll have a different name, they'll have addresses they give that aren't even real, and they will go to the end of the world to cover their tracks.
A lot of it has shifted to chatting. Criminal enterprises get smarter and smarter as we as systems get smarter and smarter. So we find that a lot of people will maybe have ongoing chat conversations, especially prior to purchasing a minor. So there might be chatting that starts up once people in the household go back to bed.
And sometimes people will think, well, I can see what my kids are doing on the computer, so I know they're not doing that. Well, then it's on their phone. We actually had one that went through the Xbox, figured out that was one of the places when the kids are playing video games that they could actually break in when they were playing the video games with other people online, and that was where they would find the type of person that they were looking to invite and to engage in this type of conversation.
But in like Snapchat too, you know, there's a feature on there called Quick Add, and you can just go down and add people, and a lot of people just accept it. And we've had cases where that's how they are getting contacted too, you know, especially youth.
We place advertisements online to combat some of the trafficking, the demand in our area. But we have accounts on all these websites. You'll never know when it's us posting because we change them pretty frequently. We talk about solicitation of kids on the internet. Most often we see it starting on these internet chat rooms. This is one that we get a lot of traffic on. You can see there's 43,000 people logged into this chat room right now. It has that in the upper right hand corner. And they'll give you a way to kind of narrow down who you're talking to. There's an interest box in here. So I put in Minnesota, and this will connect me with other people who put Minnesota in their interest box, which is most oftentimes what these guys or people who are looking to meet up on this website will do. There's no login, there's no anything that would prevent a 10-year-old kid from clicking Minnesota, hitting text, and there you are. You'll go to start chatting, and it will just start randomly connecting you with people who also like Minnesota, and they'll start talking. Oftentimes they'll start with their age, their sex, and their location. So this guy says he's a male and 16 years old. Most oftentimes they'll lie, and they'll tell you that they're 16 or 17. We've had that a lot where guys will come on here and say they're 17. They're in their mid-30s. Most of the people who are on here to have sex. We don't bring up that we're here trying to have sex with people. They bring it up first. And I've found that when I do these, if I sit down for a day and just work on these, I can usually find somebody every day. So he told me he's from Prior Lake and he's a 16-year-old male. Like I said, you can put any age that you want on here. You can just say what you are. Obviously, I'm saying I'm a 15-year-old female. They make it pretty clear that they want to meet for sex because these people don't want to drive all the way to St. Cloud if they don't know for sure that they're going to get to have sex. So oftentimes they'll ask here, what brings you on here? And that's where they're looking for you to say, oh, I'm on here trying to have sex. I don't tell people that. I make them bring it up first. He asks, what brings you on here? Same as you, probably. What is everyone on here for? Sex. So this guy told me he's an 18-year-old male from Apple Valley and is already talking about sex with a 15-year-old girl he met from St. Cloud on the internet. That's how quick that was. He asked if I was a virgin, and I said I wouldn't come on here if I was, and he said he's a virgin. Yeah, so what will happen at some point on here, because this is all anonymous, it might be a phone number, it might be a Snapchat, it might be an email, and then we have ways of identifying these people, because everything on these websites is anonymous. But it's funny because this guy says he's an 18-year-old, which would be a high school senior who's in school right now, who's on an internet chat room talking about sex with a 15-year-old. Used to end up in St. Cloud, but I don't know who he is yet. So even him asking if I'm here to have sex and asking if I'm a virgin when he knows that I'm a 15-year-old female, the solicitation of a child statute says describing or discussing sexual conduct, which we would probably want more than this, and if we sat here long enough, we would get more than this. Now he's asking to meet up. So he just asked, have a friend drive me down to Apple Valley or get driven up one night. What have we been doing this for, 5 minutes? We already have an 18-year-old who wants to meet up with a 15-year-old to have sex. He just said that he would take a lift up here, so he's willing to take a rideshare service up, then smash, then down. I would bet that there's probably, if you're just talking internet chat rooms, hundreds of them that you could sign on to and use. If I was solely dedicating nothing but my time to doing these chat rooms and solicitation, I would never run out of work to do. I could sit on here all day, and every single day I would find new people who are on the internet trying to solicit kids for sex. It would never run out. But now that this guy is disconnected, we'll have to get him a different time. And you can just start a new one, and it works just like that. Male 16.
As a parent, the biggest thing I can say to prevent your child from, you know, getting involved with some of these people online and things like that, because that's predominantly what we see in the juveniles, is the online communication, is just to really be up on the different accounts, the different social media things, you know, the trends.
Parents, get a little bit intrusive into your kids' lives, ask questions, get on the phones and kind of, you know, check who they're communicating with, what they're looking at, those type of things.
What I tell parents, guardians, caretakers to look for are changes to normal behavior, changes to normal peer groups. Again, these trafficking situations very rarely involve kidnapping and abduction. So we can usually see signs of unhealthy relationships starting to form. So it's not only important for kids and young people to know red flags of unhealthy people and unhealthy relationships, but it's good for parents to see that as well.
Be aware that there are people out there looking to manipulate kids and literally bank on that. One of the victims told us that the first time that she realized there was something outside Stearns County that she could get involved in, she was 13 years old and she was skiing at Powder Ridge. And she was on the ski lift with this 20-some year old guy, and they got to talking on the ski lift, and she'd never had marijuana before. He offered her marijuana. That was how it started. Of, hey, you know, you're a pretty girl, you're beautiful, I've got these things, hey, we should talk. And one thing led to another, but it was literally as simple as riding on a ski lift and seeing the opportunity. And that manipulation and that opportunistic quality of attracting people into this life is something that we see as basic as that.
Awareness of who their children are hanging out with. If one day you knew or know who your kids' friends are and in the next month you don't, that should be a concern. They're coming home with gifts that, or clothing or whatever that you didn't buy, and they really don't have the money to purchase themselves, that should be a red flag.
So I always tell parents, be aware of what your kids are doing on the internet, what they're doing on social media. And the best way you can do that sometimes is just be involved with it. We've had cases that started over video games. Maybe play video games with your kids. A lot of cases happen over Facebook. Check your kids' Facebook.
I highly recommend getting some kind of app that will monitor what apps and stuff they download. Like there's, you know, Life360 will track the phone. You know, there's different things that'll kind of preventative measures that they can get to at least keep an eye. You can shut down their phone at night so they're not in the middle of the night texting with somebody. You know, just things like that.
I've never interviewed a parent that wished they gave their kid more privacy on the internet and more privacy on a cell phone after the fact when they've been a victim of something. I've only heard the opposite, that they wish they had been more involved. They wish that they had asked more questions. It's never been the other way around.
People in the general public can watch and they can listen and they can pay attention and they can call. We have had 350 calls. Dispatchers know when those calls come in, where to put those, who to get them to. Then we can start looking for specific things in relation to what you're calling about.
One thing that community can do is to, you know, really pay attention to when they're responding in a victim blaming manner. Unfortunately, I see victim blaming really embedded in our communities, and it makes for those that have experienced victimization to feel like they can't come forward, they can't share their story, they can't ask for assistance.
It's the community being aware that this can happen anywhere, that it can happen here in St. Cloud, and that we need people to make sure that they understand what that might look like and where to go if they have concerns that somebody might be affected by this.
And so in being aware, then you can educate others, and then you can also know when it's important to call law enforcement and say, hey, I think something's going on at my neighbor's house or going on here or there. Should never intervene yourself, but make that call.
It's really getting everyone on board with showing versus telling us what we can really get to.
We need to warn our children. We need to give them the tools to know how to deal with online predators or someone who approaches them that way, and to understand what these people are, what they're looking for and what they're doing.
St. Cloud area in particular is really lucky because there's a vast number of resources here. There's Catholic Charities, so there's the Youth House, and they have other outreach programs. We have a drop-in center here with Pathways for Youth, Terrebinth Refuge, which serves adult women. We have 180 Degrees, which serves minors of all demographics, so girls, boys, trans youth, LGBTQ plus youth. And there's, you know, Hope Housing, and there's all these programs, TRICAP, the Regional Navigator, Supportive Services through Central Minnesota Sexual Assault Center, Anna Marie's. So really, St. Cloud is a great place with a wealth of resources.
The Centra Cares Child Advocacy Center has been, again, an unexpected partner in this. Having people who have trauma-informed interview abilities, that are able to do the medical exams, that are able to get us hooked up with the mental health services, it's critical when it happens.
The Sexual Assault Center operates the John School, or a class called Men Accountable for Sexual Exploitation. That is a one-day class that costs, I think, $750, and that's where the individuals then go and learn about what sex trafficking is.
You know, I believe our task force will come out and do a training for just about anybody. I believe they've done taxi cab drivers in the past, the Metro bus here in St. Cloud, bus drivers is another good mode of transportation that they could maybe identify something, hotel clerks.
In central Minnesota, we actually have a safe place where victims of sex trafficking can go. And to be in a place where there's going to be a warm bed, where there's going to be food, but most importantly, people who understand what's going on here. And having Cece and the staff there at Terrebinth Refuge has been invaluable. I don't know that we would be anywhere close to what we've accomplished so far without Cece being here from the very beginning.
Terrebinth Refuge is a Christ-centered shelter and safe home, and we bring hope and healing services to women who have been sexually exploited and trafficked. And so we provide holistic services to the women that come to our shelter. We have four phases in our program in which they come in, they have case management to really look at them individually and what are their goals and their needs. We provide holistic healing, so how we frame that is body, mind, soul, and spirit, healing in all of those areas.
As Terrebinth has evolved from initially kind of a crisis bed, if you will, to now they have a house that is helping women transition out of. It's just been an amazing story.
Since we started in April of 2018, we are at about 121 women that have been served over this time. And as we've grown and really strengthened our program, we have seen more and more women being able to go through all of the phases and move into their own apartments. It's always a huge, wonderful thing when we can help a woman get an apartment and help get furniture and those starting things. And they're working and really doing well. And so we've seen quite a few successes that way, and it's just, that's what we want. We want a woman to leave us knowing she's confident in making a way in this world in the areas that she's interested in.